Hey everyone, and welcome to this startup talk powered by Novelty and Incubase. Today's talk is with Giuseppe van der Helm, sustainable generalist and director of the organization Leren voor Morgen. A big thanks to our Joe Lauver and the alumni office of the University of Twente for their support. If you want to start with entrepreneurship or start your own startup, we can support you. Go to novelty.com/start. And for now, I will hand over the presentation to our master of pitching, Pieter Langelaar, who will guide this session. Thanks, Pieter, and everyone.
Okay, thank you, Niels. Welcome, Giuseppe. Nice talking to you. I look forward to this talk because I scanned your LinkedIn profile and I saw your studies here at the University of Twente, both in chemical engineering, business administration, but later theology. That is a surprising combination.
Yeah, but there are quite some years in between, of course.
So, of course, yes.
I still made a switch from a typical beta studies to more gamma, to typical alpha studies. And it took me like 20 years, perhaps, to make that switch.
Okay.
It's a story where I was working in a job, and it was a super good job. I was, on my business card, it said President Europe. That felt pretty good.
In automotive?
Automotive. I was working for Valvoline and I was heading all the business in Europe, both sales. Also, there were factories, there were licensees, etc. Some product development. And I had a lot of freedom. My boss was sitting 6,000 kilometers further in the US. I spoke to him perhaps 15 minutes every 2 weeks. So I had loads of freedom. Yeah, nice car, good salary. I was very happy. And still something was nagging inside, like, okay, is this it? Had nothing to do with sustainability. I thought it was a great product. We sell motor oil, automotive products, and still something was nagging me. And then my boss said, well, talk to some people, go to talk to a coach or whatever. So I spoke to several people, no success. Then the last person said, well, okay, you, it's not the time yet. It will come later. And then 1 year later, I was fired because this US thing, there's a new, my boss changed. And then he picks his own people, of course, and that's how it's being done. His boss, who was now heading the bigger Fortune 500 company, said, come with me, but I wouldn't want to work in the States. So there I was. And after the initial shock, I was kind of happy because this is what I wanted, right? Now it's time. I had to go into research what I wanted to do. First thing I did was go on a 2 months trip all by myself in the Pacific, so small islands.
Kind of sabbatical.
Yeah, but it's short. Small. It was like 2 months, but yeah, it was sabbatical. Actually, I was jobless, so it was in between jobs. So, and then I thought, I should read a bit. I never read a book anymore. And by then I was in my 40s. I knew myself well enough to know that that's a good intention, but it will not be realized as soon as I have another job. So I said, I have to study. I like studying. I think I'm pretty good at it. So let's do it. What study am I going to do? I had a list of three: psychology, theology, and philosophy.
Okay.
And within an hour, I said, psychology is 500. Let's say 18-year freshman, mostly female, too practical. Philosophy, very interesting, but perhaps philosophy is a study that only evokes questions, and then it should be theology. I was Catholic, so it was okay. Funny thing was, when I studied here, I made my choice in a negative way. I said to my father, I strike away all the other things that I didn't want to do, and then I was left with three options. Yeah. This one was a positive choice. So I started there. It took me a month to find out I was actually in the wrong university or a different one than I expected, and then I had a great time. It took me like 10, 11 years to complete that study.
Wow.
Because by the time I had another job, and exactly the last part was a bit tough.
Okay.
But it's it was very good. Why? Because you can ask questions all the time.
Yes, yes. You mentioned here you came to study here. It was a negative choice, but it was not a negative period because you're quite active here in the University of Twente, right? You're actually one of the founders of the student union. Not the union, but...
Association.
Association,
yeah.
That's
yeah. Beautiful. Yeah, I started here in 1979, and by then we were still a strange, let's say, transition phase, because it was still a campus university. We were supposed to be on the campus. And no student associations were allowed, actually. It's very...
It was not allowed.
You had the Studentenraad Drino, and they were supposed to be a student association, a general student association. Never worked out of the way, of course, it became kind of student union. Nothing wrong with that, but it's something completely different than the student association. And at first you had a Christian Alpha, who still existed. They were the first to break the barrier, and then within a year later you had Geiron, which should be a student core, let's say. And in that time, I was very much involved. I was the second praises after the starting.
Set. And it migrated later to what's now called Ardent.
Exactly. Yeah.
You still in touch there? You sometimes come back, or?
I'm a honorary senator, so you're a noblesse oblige. You know, of course, I come back, but not as often as I want to.
Okay. But today you are, as you mentioned before, here this ground zero.
This ground zero, yeah. The Bastille and the Kelder Bar. That's where it all started.
Yes.
And it was a very nice time. It was a kind of a struggle for survival, not only because it was a small team. You had to you have to reckon that in this university, there were lots of associations already, but they were all focused on specific sports or recreation or whatever. You couldn't mention think of something bizarre or it existed.
Yeah.
And so it is different than let's say in Leiden or in other universities where you have a big association with all kind of sub entities that focus on, for instance, hockey or whatever, or rowing. This we didn't have. So, but also there was only one thing to find your position, but also there was actively disagreement, let's say, or people that try to work you out of the whole system. That was the old campus philosophy. So I remember one moment, a friend of mine wanted to report and be active in the introduction period of the university.
Yeah,
of course, with the intention to also bring people in contact with the student associations, and we were told that was impossible. We could not be accepted because we were already linked to Geiron at that time.
Okay,
and it was very odd because we always were told that okay, you're not good because you limit yourself. You only want to attract certain people, quality of people, and in fact, it was the other way around. They didn't accept us instead of our association. It was very open to everybody, of course. So that was kind of it. That brings you together also, that you fight for it, and later on, build a move to the city, that you got a lot of good momentum going on. And I'm happy because I still see some people, certainly of us from the dispute that we started. We're still in good touch with Tranquilum. And it's good to see that some things that you start, because we talk about startup, right, are just, let's say, a coincidence. You mention something, you do something, and then it starts to be institutionalized.
It wasn't really planned. It came on your way.
I give you one example. I was heading the first introduction period, and we went out to a camp. Like, of course, we copied a lot of things from other universities, and we invented the rest. You know, it was a kind of nice melange. In that weekend, we kind of in 1.5 days, you drill the people that they all do the same things, and they say yes, many other praises from the introduction commission, isn't it? Then the Senate came, and just to check and get introduced, and they were shocked. At least my predecessor was shocked. He said, what is this? What a fascistic thing is happening. It wasn't fascistic at all. But he was shocked at the way that people behaved. And he said, we have to talk. And in that camp, we were leaving with the Senate to discuss. That was, we found out by getting back a day later, that was been very beneficial because there was a time that people hooked up together. They finally had the freedom to sit together and talk. And you see the yacht clubs being formed, etc. But that was totally not intentional. Initially, it was just like, okay, it was something that didn't go well, right?
Yeah.
In all the years after until this moment, it's institutionalized. It still happens that way. Only now it's, of course, part of the theater that you play.
I see. Is that something you recognize also in your professional life that that you say things are happening, coincidence, you cannot plan everything? Is that still valid when you are president for Europe?
Yeah. But you have an open eye on those things. And at this moment in time, we live in a time where everything is fixed with plans. You have to make a plan, you have to make a deadline, you have to scheme and a schedule, and that will help you to get there. And I can also imagine also specifically for startups, that's overwhelming sometimes. But if you have an idea, and of course a plan can help you to form that idea, but the bank will ask you for a more thorough plan, and then more thorough, and isn't it? And I think also perhaps with my theology background, it's a waste of time. The plan won't get you there. Of course, it's
what will get you there, in your opinion?
Your dream, your belief, let's say, in the that you're doing the right things. You believe in a product or a service or something that you contribute. The second thing, by the way, is that the question is, what does it contribute to? Is it only my bank account? And the plan is often that's the goal of the plan, right? You need to show the money.
Yeah.
How much are you making with that?
More or less a forecast, but you never know.
You never know what is happening.
Yes.
But you can also honor yourself, and I think that's for most of the startups the case. A startup usually is not made to be filthy rich. A startup is made because you have a dream. You have a belief in something, you have a service, you want to
provide. Passion is there.
The passion is there. Keep that passion alive and believe in that passion. And don't let you be bothered down by the plans. Secondly, you have to wonder also, what is it for? And usually it's not financially your dream. It's to bring something to the society. You want to bring something that people appreciate. You know, it does something good for society. Those elements are a bit lost in our days, I think. It's very much limited always to the financial part, because the banks, everybody asks for those plans. And secondly, they will drain you down and leave something open for imagination and also for coincidence.
Yes. That's a nice one, but you recognize it on some moment, because you graduated here from the university, you get a job, had a nice career in automotive.
Yeah.
But on some moment you changed your life, your career. What made it happen?
Well, we started by telling you a bit what happened when I was this president of Europe, and the thing which I couldn't explain at that moment to my coaches what was bothering me basically was a feeling of unfulfillment. What is it? What the workers are doing? Does it contribute something in society? Is the future generation happier? Does it make anybody happy? No, I didn't have the feeling. It has nothing to do with the nature of the product, because it's still oil, by the way, you're selling.
Oil, it's not very sustainable.
Exactly. Yeah. But at that moment in time, that was not the thing that bothered me. The question is, by selling more oil, are we going to be happier? No, that was my answer, mm-hmm. Not for me. So that's why I started to do something. And since then, I've been working in what we call the area of sustainability. But I couldn't mention it at that time. I didn't notice that it was about sustainability. By the way, sustainability is not, in my ideas, not something which has to do only with, let's say, take care of the whales or of the grow more forests. Yes, that's part of it. Mm-hmm. But the sustainability, look to the Sustainable Development Goals. That's this little thing, the 17 goals, is very broad. It has to do with how to sustain, how to live. How to continue living a good life with all the people on this planet.
And also a more equal life.
Inclusivity is a very important part of that, and diversity. So also the social elements are part of it. But it has to do with, in the word itself, sustain, it's the element of the future. There's a time element in that. It has to do with the future generations. And I think every entrepreneur should ask him or herself the same question. And they will do, because their ideas, of course, they contribute for the future. A company is not there. It's not a project. They don't have an end time. Every company wants to become royal, a company. You know, like after 100 years, you get this title, royal. Now, that's what they want to do. They want to continue and to contribute. So it's very easy and logic to think what will people need in 5 years or in 10 years and to adapt. It's more that society by itself or individuals sometimes, or and most certainly policies and governments who are more, or education if you want it, sometimes more conservative by nature, sometimes for good reasons, by the way.
Yeah. But it wasn't that hard. You had a nice job, probably a company car and probably a good credit card and that kind of things, to change that, to not only change your vision and your way of life, but also had a financial impact, I guess.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm sorry to say, I wasn't brave enough to take that own conclusion. Yeah, but somebody else took that for me. I said, okay, Giuseppe, time to change jobs, do something else. I took a decision not to go to the States, though. That was something I did. But and then I started just to think about my study, that is theology, I started to work in as a teacher, funny enough, but it was only part-time. Only 2 days a week. I learned a lot from that. And then I just looked around what kind of job do I have. And then I ended up in the world of, let's say, responsible finance, or responsible investing. But there was an area that was more coincidence. I just thought I applied for a job without knowing too much of the details. And those people had the wisdom to say, okay, it might be interesting to take somebody who was perhaps more, a bit more vocal and who knows businesses from inside. But I did not know a lot about finance. I knew very little about finance. So yeah, you can say that's a weakness. I took it always as kind of strength. But of course, knowing your weaknesses and that helped me, because then that made me ask questions that others were not asking. Was that, well, this normal? That's you can't ask that. But I'm from business life, and I always found that that businesses move, like I said, they're much more agile, they move much faster. Finance is a super conservative business, and they need to be, because it's your money that, and my money, they take care of. But to some extent, come on, why does our pension fund still invest in oil if you know? You know, it's going down. You know it for years. It's nothing new. The president the national banks warned for years and years ago, like, don't do it. There's a risk over there. And now we are left with a national, almost a national company like Shell, who even can't pay the dividends anymore, like they used to do. And now those companies, those investors sitting, okay, who's the last one who remains with that stock? You know, so move a bit faster, be a bit more agile. So that's you asked me why, what did it do to you?
Yes.
Actually, it wasn't my decision, but once I took it was kind of coincidence.
It was a part of the non-plan
thing. And I loved doing the job, but everybody brings something new, right? I didn't bring I was a bit more vocal to the financial side, but I also managed to have a lot of stakeholder dialogues where we listen to each other. So I was very happy to bring them along. And specifically, I think my strength is in business life. So I attended all the shareholder meetings. I say I, but our group, of obviously, but a lot of volunteers were happy. And we visited those shareholder meetings. And there, just by talking to the CEOs, because afterwards you have all soft lines at one-on-one, and there you could see the change happening, because you just can explain very simple words. Like, hey, it's not about us, it's about your company.
Right.
We want to think with you in your company. Let's organize stakeholder dialogue, bring in all kinds of people, customers, suppliers, employees, scientists, and let's think together what we would do if we were in your shoes. And those people thought it was very exciting, because it's of course exciting. Then usually the CEO is surrounded by people who tend him or her the good news, right? Yes. But now it was unfiltered. We didn't filter it. It was like the coincidence plays a role. And there they heard unfiltered what other people would do with the best of intentions.
Yeah.
Even their adversaries would say, "Oh, if I would be, I would do this." That's completely different than somebody tells you, "You shouldn't do it." Now we have people who think with you. It's like being in a warm bath, in a hot tub. So that makes a change, because suddenly the people heard directly from a larger group of people. And the funny thing was, in between all the diversity of your stakeholders, imagine a group of 25, 4, 5, 6 different stakeholders. They think mostly alike, even they're from very different groups. But that sends a very strong message to those CEOs.
Yes.
And that would be also one of my recommendations, like get this group of supporters, even if they might think your adversaries, bring them together. But on a one-on-one basis, don't have them talk on behalf of organization X or Y, no, just on behalf of themselves. And then put some questions forward, and then you will be surprised what kind of good advice you can get.
Very interesting. One of your main activities is now leading a Leren voor Morgen, Learning for Tomorrow.
Yeah.
Can you tell a little bit about that organization?
Yeah, a very interesting organization. Basically, what I did before in the world of responsible finance, because you have to reckon the VBDO, it was a Dutch investor organization, was kind of a mix between NGOs. There were not companies, but there were investors part of it. Also a group of accountants and consultants. So there was a mix, yeah, very odd mix, because these groups are advisors normally, so they not often sit together in one organization. Here we have is a bit more a cooperative, obviously, but there's people who make things for schools, And by the way, we talk about from childcare to universities and beyond, because it's a lifelong learning now. So part of that group develops products, books, methods, challenges, whatever, or just plain advice for schools. And partly are schools or groups of schools or associations of schools or whatever. So it's you have both of the mix, and then we have a lot of individuals or specific networks. All these groups, they're working for years on sustainability, sometimes just on their own job. There might be a teacher who's working on a certain, some lessons they want to develop. And what would be interesting, of course, is that you have those practices shared. So somebody who does something in Groningen can share that with somebody in Maastricht. So far, that didn't happen a lot, although there were some good, very good associations where you have those individuals together. What we try to bring is say, okay, all these best practices, all these good practices that exist already, let's share them and also bring them forward to the let's say the ministry, for instance, who is not too much worried about sustainability, very odd. And let's bring it forward also to the leaders of those schools are almost all busy with, we have not enough teachers, or the money is not enough, we have to make these plans and plans again. And all these plans don't help you. And then when you go to those schools, they might often say, okay, and it also applies perhaps to this university, I don't know. They often say, okay, yeah, sustainability. But you said, it's so busy already, there's so many things now, another element. And then I say two things. First of all, sustainability is not another subject, another topic you have to do. It's your primary process. It has to do with the future of your students. Yeah, isn't that your only job in the world as an education institution? To help your students to thrive in the world of tomorrow? Don't you have to think about tomorrow then? That's not what's happening. Very often we look backwards. Certainly, the subjects we teach are the same as 100 years ago.
Right.
So that's one thing. And secondly, sustainability, it's not one topic. It has to be in all your subjects. It's about integration. It's about a different way of teaching, whereby it's less about knowledge transfer. Of course, you need basic knowledge, but bring skills, teach them skills. Look to Corona. There's not too much knowledge of what it was, but we need skills like think critical. Think of all the conspiracy theories, work together. Be creative, be entrepreneurial. Those are basic 21st century skills, as we call them. These are very important, but you have to practice them in reality. Don't teach them on a paper, do some projects together. And I always thought, okay, yeah, cooperating, working together, we all know that that's happening, or think critical. But if you look at the Corona as an example, what about critical thinking? Look at all the crazy theories we see passing by. What about cooperation? You know, grown-up men from Western democracies are just fighting each other for this breathing machines. Who gets the first and who gets the first vaccine? It's actually a pretty bad what's happening there. Yeah. So I think working with students with those skills, they will be good. So that's our struggle to show not only the people make the policies, but also yep. people in the schools or leaders, the boards, to show them what does it mean. What would you mean with sustainability in all elements? Yeah, look at sustainable development goals, and help them share the best practices to do so, and then create space and money to implement.
Okay, talking about Corona and sustainability, I think the virus also forces to think different about the way we work together and travel and spend time together. Things that we might thought of, we cannot travel less. We have to meet each other on the drive 2 hours to Amsterdam for 1 hour meeting, for example. Things have changed. Will the change be permanent? Will it go back as it used to be? Or are we learning from it?
Yeah, the answer I would say give is like, it will change. And we have to see the positive things in this whole process. In a practical way, you let's say working from home. Yeah, we've heard a lot of bitching and moaning. People say, okay, but we'll all by ourselves, and we don't have enough equipment, and then we have to get more money for that, and then a lot of bad things. Yesterday, I saw a questionnaire to 500 people who were working for the city where I live in. Funny enough, the majority said, in the future, if this is over, We are not going to work more than 2 days a week in the office. So apparently, they saw this as something positive. We didn't hear it so far. We heard about the negative side, but people enjoy that. Of course, we have things you want to still meet personally. In the past, you say drive for 1 hour to Amsterdam. Of course, I've been in a whole team with 5-6 people in a plane flying business class to the States for a meeting or 3 hours. That is totally crazy. So, yes. But at that time we thought it was nice and exciting. And now, at this moment, you say, okay, this we can do that. This is not sustainable. So, that's one thing on the practical side. Yep. Secondly, what I also see, also with specifically with younger people, they're really thinking about, okay, how will my life look like? They really think, what impact does this have, or it might be in the future, or my life? What is really of relevance, and how can I really contribute to that world? And I hope that we get that a bit more. You know, everything we do is always measured, like as we started, in terms of models, of plans, of figures, what's a return rate. We are in an education branch, you could say, we are all raised to be a very productive part of society. Huh? How can you be, what's your return? Because we invested this money in you, you better be a good boy or girl. And I think we shouldn't continue with that. People should, they see people, you know, the consequences, you live lives, and certainly you are in a machine and in a hospital and you can die. So it makes you also reflect on what's really of the essence for the world, how will society look like in the future, and for me, how do I get my satisfaction? It's the same kind of questions I ask myself after so many years, and I hope that the people from this time, they ask some questions a bit earlier than I did.
Okay, now we talk about questions, and questions are coming in via the chat, so I will ask some questions. One is from Rens Dommelholt. How can you develop a culture of learning in a startup? A culture of learning in a startup.
Yeah, I think it's there's a couple of things. First of all, I think include your stakeholders, talk to people, because by talking, if you accept, they talk back, of course. And then you have a discussion with other people, right? And I think it's very good to ask, to think in terms of questions, not of answers. Yeah. Now, like when I made this point, I asked myself some questions or was of relevance. We did the stakeholder dialogues, and it took the most time you spent is on asking what are the good questions we're going to ask. And that's by itself. Then you are in the mode of learning, and then you bring their people from outside, or you could also do it inside, of course, with a couple of colleagues or friends, and you discuss to ask questions. And that's how you're learning.
Nice. By the way, this is a good moment to ask more questions to Giuseppe. And saying that, Andreas Beer, hi Andreas, nice that you are with us, is asking, all organizations need resources to operate effectively. In which ways can sustainability organizations generate resources if they do not focus on profit?
Oh, profit is not the goal, it's something you need. So so it's a means. Let's put it that way. It's a means to be sustainable, to have a sustained business model. Yeah, so
but in the past, profit was a goal.
I don't think it's a goal at all. It's wrong goal. The goal is something that you want to contribute to society, or and of course, there's nothing wrong by earning money. But the money is usually for the company, and then you grow more. You know, I did Catholic theology. And then one thing I learned is in Catholic social law, in the 19th century, the Pope was asked to be, what do you think of capitalism, basically? And because it was hardcore capitalism in those days. And then he said, he thought about it. He said, capitalism is okay. You can make profit. But there's one condition. You have to give it back to society. You have to go back to the bonum communum, to the common good, so to say. That's a time when Catholic people, entrepreneurs like Philip started to build living spaces, you know, houses, or invest in football clubs like we still have today.
Yeah.
So I think you have to think more. That concept got a bit lost in the ages after, of course, because now it's all about the business model and the profit. So the resources, you can find resources. Keep in mind, we have at this moment in time, in this country, we still haven't found a solution, but in other countries, you have companies, profit-oriented, NGOs, not for profit. There's in between, you have the social enterprises. Enterprises bring something, with not a goal of making money. Of course you make money because you need money to pay the salary, for instance, so everybody has to make a living. But you bring something to society, and then they have a special, like you have a BFA, they have another word for, we don't have that, legal status for those social companies. And that is still a great idea. We need a lot of startups to develop those things that you bring to society. Mm. Now, resources has another element in it. So I was not sure what the guy who asked the question.
Yeah, Andreas, he generate resources if they do not focus on profit. So
yeah, so the resource is money problem. Resources in my world also has to do with things you need. Yeah, goods.
Yeah,
to create something, you need to pay them with money, of course. But now we talk, make a very serious point, of course, about the sustainability, because we need to go to a circular economy. And 2050, everything we do should be circular. So the chairs we sit on have to be reused or reworked. We cannot throw anything away anymore. 2050 is nearer than you think. I think in 2030 already applies to 50% of everything. It didn't get a lot of attention so far. But if you have a startup that can find solutions to these elements, that would be great, because then you're a winner. That's something that helps our planet forward.
Right. So we have a start program. Andreas was one of the startups in the program. How could we teach or make them more realize that sustainability is an important thing? Because I do a finance workshop and how to pitch and business modeling, but what part of sustainability should we teach there as well?
I think everything that helps address the problems where we are in now, and that helps to build a society for our kids. Yeah, for the next generation, you're happy and that you can thrive, you have no bottlenecks, you can be the person you want. That helps. And the way to do that is, I think, to look for examples, because there's so many good examples of people or startups or in education where people already think by themselves, they just do it. Huh? But now the idea is to connect it and to speed up, because we are really, it's not something like fashionable or something. We are really in a sense of urgency, because developments, and that's also something that startups should recognize, they used to go in a linear way, and now they go exponential way. We know what it means from the virus, yeah. You know, exponentially, yeah. Now we understand that. We know it, of course, from our books, but we as a species, human beings, we are not equipped. We cannot understand that. We understand that we in 26 steps, we are the other side here of this room. But if it's exponentially and doubles every step, we are around the world. That's something we cannot grasp, but because of everything's IT based nowadays, you see the law of Moore, of course, and it's going exponentially. So we are in a sense of urgency. This is why people are worried about climate change, because it's not like, okay, Yossi, we did one step, you can go one step back. No, it goes exponentially. It's already doubling. And exponentially, you don't notice before it's too late. You don't notice before it's too late. Because if it's too late, the last 50% is doubling, right? So you think, okay, we go a bit step back. No, it's already the doubling. So if as a startup, you have to recognize with that, but also the good news is every development you do in the right direction is also exponential.
That's
so
the good news, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, good news. So you can walk back. And I think for your question, it would be very good to share those good practices and to link people. That's what we try to do as cooperation for education, but it's in general, because then you inspire each other, and one person has an idea with some bottlenecks, and the others think, okay, I can help you with doing that. We need to work much more together in that respect.
Nice. Nice. More questions are coming in. For example, Tamara is asking, you did a lot of things and I notice you don't like to think in concrete and solid plans. But is there something you want to achieve in the upcoming 5 years in the field of sustainability? And what do you need for that? Nice question, Tamara.
That's a very good question. So that makes me reflect. Thank you very much for that question. And on the way back, I certainly took a reflect. But actually, I start to reflect. For the time being, of course, it is in the field of education. And my big goal is to have that more, and it's not the right words I use, more institutionalized. But I hate institutionalization. Huh? By the way, I think as a startup, hang on to your dream. Don't let it be institutionalized in the current business, yeah? Because there are powers that will try to make you a good boy or girl, and you have to adapt to the system. But your startup with your dreams that are doing something specifically. So you have to adapt and make it workable, but keep on to your dream. So what I try to do with education is make sure that there is both from ministry level, but also in the schools, people create the facilitate this development. They create room in time, in money, so that they allow the teacher much more freedom to, let's say, work with projects, start to get students and pupils in the lead, that they have questions. Start with those questions, work with those questions, have them find out themselves the right things. And that way you develop the skills, and you give them the right basic training that they need. But there's much more fluid, less structured approach. That's what's my hope is. I'm sure we'll get there, but it's tough because people have to understand what's sustainability is. On a higher level, I have no clue how to do that, but I'm kind of worried because it seems we are much more thrown back to ourselves. And I would like to think how we can change that. What do I mean with that? We live in a world that's based on the models and the returns, and we're also living in a world where there's religion, for instance, or let's say beliefs in something outside yourself don't play a role anymore. So you all turn back to yourself. If you do something good, it's your of course, because of you, not always, because you could have been lucky, right? But people say, okay, it's me. And we are told that, okay, if you do the right things, if you believe in yourself, do the right steps, everybody can be successful. The American dream, perhaps on an international level. But that's totally bullshit. It's not true, because there is contingencies. Things happen on your path that they happen in mind, and they are positive, and sometimes they are negative. That's not always because of me. It's something that happens to you. In religious terms, we phrase it, of course, as more, it comes from the spirit or something else. But it's called the universe. Things come on your path. Be happy if they're positive, and don't be bothered too much when it's negative, go around that. So the idea is that you create a very individual world. When things are not okay, you know, you're on the ball because it's you to blame. And it also leads to the fact that we are less, perhaps a bit less involved with each other, or less social. There's some drastic words, and sorry about that. But let's put it this way. If you look at all the voluntary organizations, sports clubs, whatever, a lot of it has been still being carried by elderly people. You know, because we're retired, they spend a lot of time at that, which is very positive. But younger people think more in terms of projects. They want to do something nice. They make a good picture on Instagram, a bit sarcastic now. But they love to work as of on these projects. But how do you get those people also getting involved, especially nitty-gritty nasty work of running an organization, something which you need for other people? I'm sure they will get there, but the question, how does it work? So how do we create a connection in between individuals again?
Yeah, nice. Question from Renz. The educational system is often not looked at as innovative. But what is something educational organizations do better than most startups? So what educational organization better than most startups?
So the last sentence,
What is something educational organizations do better than startups? Ah. Rens?
What do they do better than startups?
And do they? That's the question.
Yeah, I wish sometimes they would be more like a startup, right? So what they do, definitely do better. They have a lot of good contacts with government, and they are very stable. They make plans and address some of the issue. But I think it's more the other way around. I would say I wish the education world has a bit of less planning and a bit more of room for startups. Okay. And then you see the individual qualities are very important. You can have it in a certain school. You have two teachers. One teacher says, I believe sustainability is very important, but I can do anything because, you know, I have my quality standards, I have my rules, I have to do this much tests, and I have these at the end of it, I need this standard applied to this criteria for examination. So, I can't. The colleague next door, same school, same standard, says, Giuseppe, I'm totally happy. I do so many things with my students. I bring them out. I have projects. I have things. But I said, what about the strategy? Of course, that will automatically help them. So this is not about the rules. This is about their own individual, as an entrepreneurship or something, or belief in that that's the way forward, and just find things out. And that's, I think, a key thing, and that's nothing new for an entrepreneur with a startup, but that's something I find. Start somewhere, do something, you know. You have to do something, and along doing, you learn. And again, that's opposite of the planning. And again, it seems like I never make a plan. Of course, plans are also important, but I firmly believe. I'll give you one example. I spoke, I'm also heading a covenant in the, how do you call it, international corporate sociability, about the gold sector. And there we... there's companies again, and there's NGOs, and there's governments, and together they have specific goals. And then we said, well, we have all these problems in, well, problems. There's an issue, of course, in the small mines. There's, you know, kind of things not well, but we have projects. If you manage to get it good gold out of there, yeah, on the right circumstances, how can we bring it to Holland? And it said, yeah, but your business is going to go that far, and we need to finance it, and it doesn't work. And we first have to make a good plan. Even the NGOs said, well, I have to make a business plan, otherwise. And then one person stood up, and he's working in this organization where they bring gold from telephones to Holland. And he said, no, you just forget about it. You need proof of concept. You need to start somewhere. You just bring 200 grams. And I said, and everybody said, yeah, we can do this. I said, can you tell me, were you successful when you made up your plans? And did you make any money? No, we didn't make any money. And did you start there? Yeah, 200 grams. And are you making money now? Yes, we are making money now. But just start somewhere, do something, and moving along, you will learn something, perhaps from the negative elements, but something from your positive elements.
Okay, in line with that, there is another question. If the main goal of your startup is not sustainability, how do you think you should innovatively incorporate this into the startup plan?
But that's key, because sustainability by itself, it's so broad, it's perhaps not a goal. It should also underlie your ideas. But then your ideas should be, ask yourself, what will it bring to society? What will my product or service bring to society? And then you can use a checklist of the sustainable development goals, because they look to all those different elements, for example, right? And that will help you to find that question.
Okay, that's nice. That's
and will
nice.
It work in for my grandchildren, for instance?
Yeah. Andreas, another question from Andreas Beer. You emphasize the importance of bringing different parties to the table to discuss constructively. How do such meetings come about? What is a good way to reach out to different parties? How do you connect them?
Yeah, that's a good question, of course, certainly as a startup. You know, when I organize a stakeholder dialogue for a large company, then it's rather easy to find people. But in your startup, you might have to go to places. Yeah. And then drinking the cups of coffee, the famous cup of coffee, or perhaps something stronger, I use that help. My current job, I got this times during a beer, drinking a beer with something in a cafe.
On a Friday afternoon.
It was not after this job at all. I was asking something else about my future planning. What should I do? I was already left my previous position. I said, oh, by the way, why is this something for you? It might have fist you. Came along my way. And I thought, reflecting, yeah, that's super, because it's very much like I did within the area, which I have already experienced, because I did work as a teacher part-time. So that was perfect. It wasn't part of the plan.
No, but that is a little bit of the storyline. It's not part of the plan. But if you believe in it and you really are passionate about it, it will also come to you.
It will come to you, and then, but then you keep on moving, right? So you have this idea, and then you start talking to people, and well, I guess if I understand the question right, my suggestion would be just go out there and talk to them, but don't forget to use different stakeholder groups. You might find the answer more in a different group, and keep also in mind, I think the differences sometimes between let's say a hardcore company, let's say a super commercial, and an NGO. They're more vague, getting more vague and vaguer every time. You know, you have all kinds of spinners for NGOs who want to make a profit. And of course, you have companies who are social enterprises. So think broad, let's put it that way.
Okay, nice. This is about your job, career, but you do also voluntarily work. You're chairman of Stichting Leergeld.
Yeah.
PCI Vianen. Is it, in your opinion, important to do voluntarily work? And is it also part of being sustainable?
I think so. Because I do it for my case. First of all, the first answer is, of course, you remember the question, like what do you worry about, what I want to achieve in 5 years? My worry about ever get more individualistic. And I think it's kind of your, I always have it done since I was end of my 20s, volunteer work, because it keeps you, it's kind of, the thing I do for a society, let's put it that way. It's kind of my, yeah, duty sounds very formal, but I think it's kind of normal. You do something back. Society gave me a lot, I give something back. It's one thing. Secondly, what this does to me, it helps me make up my feet in society. Because the two clubs, the two things you mentioned are local. Huh? It's not. It's just for the local. It's you could say it's nothing special, something local. But in the past, in the morning I left my town where I live. In the evening I come back. I there's hardly any connection. Yep. But there's all kind of things. The whole life is happening over there, always in a real place, in a real town. And these two associations are very much involved in people who are not so lucky. You know. For one way or the reason, they are into problems. They cannot make the ends meet, or the kids cannot make ends meet, and that keeps you in touch with all these things are happening. I've been working also in a helpline. This is my first voluntary job, and I was kind of shocked to hear the stories from people on the phone. And I knew those people, when you go out on the street, they look like you and me. You don't see it from the outside. Yeah. You don't see it in the houses they live, but they're among us. And they have a total different, lot of negative experiences. They're really suffering. And it's easy, you know, sometimes when you're fortunate to walk on life and see things pass by. But this gives you kind of a feeling, okay, this is also our society, and how to deal with that. And what can we do to help or better to prevent those things, knowing that bad things always will happen and you can never totally prevent it, but how you deal with it then, at least.
Okay, we're almost at the end of a very inspiring and interesting story. There are now a lot of young people and also some older like me, but a lot of young people watching and listening. We're going towards a period of what's going to happen with Corona and what will happen with Christmas. What is your message to them?
Well, Christmas will happen every year anyway. So we'll have celebrate Christmas also, of course, the start of something new. And perhaps you should see this crisis. We all know this, and I think it was Japanese. It also means something very great, something new, right? So let's see it as this part of also for young people, see something positive in everything. My generation did something wrong because when I was born, we still had one planet was enough for all the population. Yeah, we were living on one planet. Now we need 3.5 planets and we only have one. So I was there. I, in spite of all my positive thinking, I was part of that thing. And I think it's a good point in the Christmas holidays under the tree, start feeding your dream, building your dream, and think what do we need in order to get back to this one planet? And what do we need to make inclusive world where everybody belongs in all our diversity? And what can you do to create that world? That way you'll help that world, but also will be very fulfilling for yourself. And in what business model that do, that's totally up to you, but keep your dream and keep it alive. Keep on feeding it and ask people to water your dreams, to help them grow your dreams.
Okay. Giuseppe, thank you very much for this inspiring talk. Nice stories. I hope, and I'm sure you inspired a lot of the people on the other side of the camera. At least inspired me. So thank you for that.
You're welcome.
Thank you all for being with us in this talk. We will organize more talks. And of course, you can find them on novelty.com/events. Have a nice day.
Great.
Yeah, it was nice.
Thank you.